Alfred Hitchcock is widely known as the master of suspense, but how he gained that title? We'll have to go all the way back to the beginning of his life. Hitchcock was born on August 13th, 1899, and at the age of six, his family moved to Limehouse on the east part of London, which is near where Jack the Ripper carried out a series of killings 11 years before Hitchcock was born. In 1914, three events occurred in his life. World War I started, he left St. Ignatius College and joined the engineering firm Henley's, and his father passed away. Around this time, Hitchcock began work as a titled card designer.
I was a very keen moviegoer, and I heard that an American company were coming to London to open a studio, so I applied for the job of designing their titles, because those were the silent days, and titles were an important part of the picture.
Hitchcock became an assistant director in Michael Bolton's first film, released in 1923, Women to Women. In 1924, Hitchcock co-wrote The Blackguard. While working on the film in Germany, Hitchcock studied several films that were being made nearby, including The Last Laugh. The Last Laugh would become an inspiration for many of his films. His first film that he directed was The Number 13 in 1922. Plagued with financial problems, it was pulled from production after only a few scenes were shot. His first picture he directed that was released was The Pleasure Garden in 1925. This was the first of 10 silent films that he would direct. On this project, he hired his soon-to-be wife, Alma Revel, as assistant director and editor. It was written by Elliot Standard, who would later co-write a majority of Hitchcock's silent films. Hitchcock's second film, The Mountain Eagle, in 1926, is now lost. His third film, The Lodger, in 1927, was a huge success. Based on a popular novel by Marie Beller Clowns, which is about Jack the Ripper, many of the shots were inspired by German Expressionism.
That's the visual interpretation of the missing sound of those days. In other words, a man is pacing a room up and down today. We'd do it by sound and you would see the chandelier shaking. Well, the substitute for that was a visual impression of the room above, and you saw the soles of his shoes and the full length of his body and the ceiling of the room beyond as he paced up and down. And I did it by having a floor made of 1-inch thick glass. When I had finished The Lodger, the director that I had been working for was looking at the rushes and reported to the producer. He said, "I don't know what the devil he's shooting. I don't understand a word of it." And finally came an afternoon when the big shot was coming down to verify his menial's verdict on the picture. And I remember my wife and I walked out of the studio and went for 2 hours. We found ourselves at Tower Bridge. I said, "Well, it must be over by now. Let's go back." Hoping, of course, this is the most suspenseful moment I've ever had, to go back and find smiling faces. It's all right, he likes it. But not a bit of it. He confirmed it, and they put the film on the shelf. Stayed on the shelf for about 2 or 3 months. And they said, "Well, we have an investment in this. Better take a look at it again." And they finally agreed to show it. And then it was acquired as the greatest British film made to that period.
The opening of Hitchcock's 1927 film, The Ring, is a great example of montage. Hitchcock admired the Russians and their use of montage, as seen in this example. Hitchcock's first talking picture, also advertised as Britain's first talkie, was Blackmail in 1929. One of the challenges was the starring actress, Annie Andra, has a heavy Czech accent.
"Now, Miss Andra, you asked me to let you hear your voice on the talking picture."
"But, Hitch, you mustn't do that."
"Why not?"
"Well, because I can speak well."
"Do you realize the squad van will be here any moment?"
"No, really. Oh, my God, I'm terribly frightened."
"Why, have you been a bad woman or something?"
"Well, not just bad, but this."
"But you slept with men?"
"Oh, no."
"You have not? Come here. Stand in your place. Otherwise, it will not come out right, as the girl said to the soldier." "That's enough."
Well, the main problem concerned the fact that I had a Czech film star playing the part of an English girl. So there the problem cropped up. How do we get around the problem of Miss Andra speaking with a heavy foreign accent? Now, in those days, we couldn't substitute voices with the ease with which we do today. So I had a young actress, Joan Barry, sitting on the side with her own microphone while Miss Andra, on the set, playing her scene, just mouthed her words. So the girl on the side had to follow her very closely.
You and your Scotland Yard. If it weren't for Edgar Wallace, nobody'd ever heard of it.
Funny, aren't you? Anyway, what's the hurry? We're only going to the pictures. We've got all evening.
Well, I don't think I want to go to the pictures.
And then Hitchcock released Waltzes from Vienna, which was considered to be the lowest point in his career. But his next film, The Man Who Knew Too Much, in 1934, is considered to be his best British film. According to the BBC documentary, Paul Merton looks at Hitchcock. This is also in which he gained the title The Master of Suspense.
But then the Hitchcocks began a new collaboration with the writer Charles Bennett. The resulting screenplay, The Man Who Knew Too Much, also benefited from discussions with other like-minded professionals at the Hitchcocks' flat in Cromwell Road. The Master of Suspense was born.
When you choose a location, it must not be a background. The goings-on in that location must be involved in the story. For example, in the assassination which is about to take place, when the cymbals crash, that's the time for the shot to go off.
Went off all right.
I hope so, for all our sakes. She was killed by a foreign agent who was interested too.
Did she tell you what the foreign agent looked like?
It wasn't time. No, there was one thing. Part of his little finger was missing.
Which one?
This one, I think.
Sure it wasn't this one?
And if... Listen, there's something you ought to
Hello,
know.
Can you come along quietly?
Yes, but look here, that man on the stage.
Hey, look here, old man, you don't want to cause any trouble and spoil people's entertainment.
General Gordon dead. Where's the capital of...
What are the 39 steps? Come on, answer up! What are the 39 steps?
The 39 steps is an organization of spies collecting information on behalf of the Foreign Office of...
His next film was 39 Steps. Released in 1935, this film is one big chase scene. Hitchcock's set designers paid very close attention to his instructions, as seen in these examples. In his next film, Secret Agent, released in 1936, his star actor, Peter Lorre, became addicted to morphine.
Oh, it's terrible! Impossible, man! It's awful! This is too much! Really too much! For you, beautiful woman! And what for me? What for me? Nothing! Nobody, nothing! No, this... Caramba, de Dios!
In The Sabotage, also released in 1936, Hitchcock made a grave mistake that would haunt him for many years. The boy is carrying a bomb, but doesn't know it. Just watch what happens.
I once committed a grave error in having a bomb from which I'd extracted a great deal of suspense. And I had the thing go off, which I should never have done, because they needed the relief from their suspense. Clock going, the time for the bomb to go off is such a time, and I drew this thing out and attenuated the whole business. Then somebody should say, oh my goodness, look, there's a bomb. Pick it up, throw it out of the window, bang! But everybody's relieved. Yeah. I made the mistake, I let the bomb go off and kill someone. Bad technique.
In this scene, Hitchcock keeps his roots as a silent film director.
let out!
His next film, Young and Innocent, in 1937, has a great example of the use of the moving camera.
You ought to order tea or something if we're going to stay here long.
What cigarette, dear?
In this situation, you have a young girl with a hobo, a tramp, you see, and he's the only man who could identify this murderer. And all they know is that he has some vitus dance in the eyes.
Haven't you seen anyone with a twitch yet?
And the old boy said, well, this is idiotic. In a big room like this, trying to find a man who has twitching eyes. And at that moment, I take the camera high up into the lobby of the hotel and do the longest dolly shot through the lobby, through the ballroom, through the dancers.
I'm right here to tell you, sister, no one can like the drummer man. Every man who plays in the band is wonderful too. I've got to give credit where credit is due. But when it comes to make that music up, make you give it all it's got, I'm right here to tell you, mister.
Through a minstrel black-faced band, right through the band to the drummer, to his head, and right to his eyes.
His next film, The Lady Vanishes in 1938, is one of his best-remembered British films. Though the studio that it was filmed in was small, he used filming techniques like using models and rear projections. After that, Hitchcock and his family moved to Hollywood, still making movies with that silent technique in mind. Regarded as Britain's best director, Hitchcock's career struggled early on before reaching the level of success that his body of work has come to be known. Hitchcock truly is the master of suspense.
That was beautifully put. In fact, after hearing that, there's nothing more I wish to add.